Welcome to the webinar about artificial intelligence and its applications, especially in the food and beverage sector. My name is Ralf Grobmann. Thanks for having me. And I'd like to give you some insights about my work area of interest, that is artificial intelligence, and the different industrial applications of AI. So, coming to the agenda of the webinar, I'd like to start off with the demystification of artificial intelligence, which is, I would say, currently peaking in interest, and it's a very hot topic coming around with buzzwords like neural networks and deep learning. And I'd like to share some background of this with you because it's not that new technology. It has its roots in the late 40s. We had also, let's say, some neural winter, first and a second neural winter of artificial intelligence. And I'd like to point out that nowadays there are some interesting new things, but it's not every time the case. Having demystified artificial intelligence, I like to focus on a couple of use cases, especially from the domain of image recognition. That is, how can visual quality inspections can be automated by using convolution neural networks and the balance of cloud and edge computing. The analysis of production processes, which are especially interesting in the food and beverage sector, because you have resources and products which in a natural way vary in their quality, and you have to cope with the difficulties arising from that. Apart from focusing on production data and data from production processes, you can also apply artificial intelligence models and algorithms to augment and support and improve business administration processes, planning processes. And here I like to share some insights with you on how to make predictions of customer demand in the context of enterprise resource planning. I also like to point out that the key success factors behind AI projects, it's not only having the right data and tons of right data, but you also have to have the experience in finding the right methods and models, but there is even more behind this. And here I like to point to some directions how you should deal with AI, especially in industrial application. Concluding, I like to point to some trends which are also important, I guess, for the food and beverage sector and arena. But now let's start off with the demystification of artificial intelligence. It is a really broad field. I mean, every algorithm, every model that is able to mimic human behavior, especially when you need intelligence to do a specific task or operation, you can call artificial intelligence or a piece of artificial intelligence. Here I like to focus on data analytics, which is also a sector apart from, for instance, robotics in artificial intelligence, where you typically have a cognitive system which has three, let's say, basic functions. First one is perception, then you build a model from the perception, so internal model of the world, a representation which is able to identify patterns and to give recommendations, and then you have the implementation of actions, and this is decision making under uncertainty. So perceptions for me is data with respect to numerical data, image data, it could be sounds, vibrations, high dimensional data of different interacting variables. I can also analyze unstructured data like text documents, service technician reports, for instance. And the goal is to build models from that that are able to identify patterns in the data and correlate the patterns that you see on the input and find a relation to the output that could be a product quality, that could be a specific customer demand. You build a model from this data, and it is typically a statistical, a mathematical model. And when it comes to the or when it comes from the field of machine learning or artificial intelligence, it is inspired, for instance, by biological processes like the ones that take place in the human brain when you model with, for instance, neural networks. But at the end, the model is a statistical mathematical model which is able to cope with high dimensionalities in data, to cope with non-linearity in data. It's a bounded world. We have to have, let's say, synergies, degression effects, and therefore you need a non-linear instrument to handle these specifics. And then you have to implement an action, a form of decision support under uncertainty. A model is not always perfect. There could be hidden influences, shocks that you do not see in the data. And therefore you also always are in the need of finding a robust decision. And of course, the consequences of your decision you see again in the perception. So you see how the system responds to your actions and how you can go further on the base of your decision making. Here I like to give you some more background on one of the most, I would say, prominent models that are used nowadays, especially for image recognition, which are convolution neural networks. So just a brief sketch of how convolution neural networks work. I typically start off with an image which consists for me of a matrix for the values for red, green, and blue. So I have three matrices. Depending on the image resolution, you can deal, for instance, with 224 times 224 times 3, so medium resolution picture. And then the convolutions in the first phase of the image processing, they are used to extract features in an automated manner from the image. And typically you have more than one convolution layer, you have pooling layers, so that that extract the edges, the corners, specifics of the image, and you end up by having a larger feature map of the image, which holds all the information of the objects that in an abstract representation, and then you do a classification of the features that you have identified in the or from the image. And this is the second step where you have a classifier. It could be a neural network, it could be a simple linear combiner of those features. And you could, for instance, classify different classes. So the occurrence probability P0 to P1, 2, 3 to PN, if there is a specific characteristic or object included in the image or not. Could be, for instance, a scratch or a failure, what you see, or a specific object that you can classify given given the data and pictures from the object and other objects that are accessed and pre-processed and processed by the neural network. And I will come to that later when we see how especially visual quality inspections can be automated by using such kind of neural networks. So where do I see the specific applications fields of deep learning and artificial intelligence? I would say we have four. I mean, typically you can deal with the data of a component, and you can could be a pump or could be a compressor, and you can study if there is a wear or if there is an increased probability for a failure, and based on that data. You can, and the analysis of the data given a model that you have built, you can suggest, for instance, maintenance measures in order to ensure the uptime of the machine as a whole. There is also possibility to not only component data, but data from production processes to analyze that data to learn where you have scrap in the production process, what are the driving factor of a specific product quality. There is also a cross-link to digital twins and simulation models where machine learning helps to calibrate simulation models in a better way, where you also can learn models where you have no or no complete insights in the physics of the system behind, and then you can use a black box model that helps you to cope with the difficulties in your simulation model. What you can also do is you can diagnose while failures or while scrap has happened in the production process, and give hints to ensure the product quality. So I would say these are three fields that are more or less related with production data, with component data, so which is more or less related to the production process itself. What you can also do, and I'd like to show you also one example here, is how you can support business planning processes, for instance, by predicting customer demand or by predicting company figures like order intake or revenue with such kind of nonlinear regression models. You can also forecast commodity prices like prices for electrical energy, natural gas, or oil, for instance, or industrial base metals. And there's also a field where you can do customer scoring, where you can analyze or assess project risks based on the data that you have from the projects. And here also machine learning can help you to optimize your workflow. Let's come to one use case, which is the digital transformation of visual quality inspection, where we augment a production line. The automation that is done here is typically on a very high level. And now suppose that we add a camera that focuses on the objects that were produced. For instance, if they have a smooth surface or the surface shows some scratches. Here you see one object that comes on this conveyor belt. A picture is taken, and with the first, let's say, sample of image data, say we have 200 or 300 different images of such a cube. Some of them show, let's say, scratches, some not. We start the data pre-processing and the model building. So pre-processing means that we enrich the small data sample, manipulating it. You can rotate the images, for instance, to increase the data sample. Then you have the data science part, so you do the model building based on typically the open source platforms like Python, Keras, TensorFlow, where you do the model building using convolution neural networks. You compare the model in different variants, also to traditional algorithms of image recognition, doing offline proof of concept and benchmarking of the model, and if it fulfills the customer requirement, you compile it and you put it into action, meaning it comes from the cloud again on an to the production line on an edge device, and the edge device triggers then decisions like to sort out unwanted objects and unwanted effects. I'd like to show you a short video where you see on the first thing packaging of a product. So if the device itself, a handbook, a disk, a cable is included in the box, so it's a quality control. And then also from the field of quality control, you see on the video where we have an image and we determine cold contacts on or from soldering. Let's see. So you see here the staff puts together the box, runs a inspection, closes the box, and everything is complete. And now you see here on the soldering, broken pins are identified in real time. Here too, it's shown in the video by a red square that these contacts or that you have soldering bridges. And you can sort out and you can guarantee for a specific or predefined product quality. And by this, you automize visual quality inspections that typically are costly and are done by human experts. What you can also do is you can augment production processes in order to ensure the product quality. Especially in food and beverage, you have natural ingredients or resources that vary in their quality from year to year. Maybe they depend on the sun hours, or if you had a rainy summer, then the product quality might be, or the quality of your natural ingredients might change. Nevertheless, you have a predefined quality that you like to have in your product or a specific taste. And with such a neural network or machine learning model, you can set up and learn the function relationships between the varying of the input side and how it affects your product quality on the output side. And also questions that might arise are: can you reduce or even avoid scrap in the production? And how you also can save costs or be more efficient, for instance. So how does it work? Again, we are analyzing data from the production process, and here we apply deep learning, for instance, in order to learn the relationship between the different characteristics on the input side, what you use as natural ingredients, production parameters that you have, could be temperatures, extraction times, for instance, maybe also analytical models or results from other analyses coming from your laboratory, we learn the relation to, for instance, the KPIs of your product or the product quality. And then you can also question what are potential factors which are very important for the product quality and what are factors which are not so important. And on this basis, of course, you can implement controllers, control strategies in order to improve your process. So, for instance, how does the identification of important input variables look like? Typically, we perform a sensitivity analysis where you see, on the one hand, over the different production batches, you see the sensitivity matrix on the left-hand side over different input variables. The more intense the color, the more important is an input. If the color is red, it's a positive relationship. If the color is blue, it's a negative relationship. So blue means if you increase the input, your product quality or the KPI that you model will decrease. And blue means and red means, of course, if you increase if you increase the input, then also your product quality will increase. And if you summarize this, for instance, by looking at the absolute normalized sensitivities over the different inputs, you would see that here in this production process, there are four driving factors behind the product quality, which seem of a very of a predominant importance for judging the product quality. And on this basis, you can, for instance, detail with the engineering on how to improve the product quality then. You can not only apply such models to the analysis of production processes or for image recognition, you can also use models, especially recurrent neural networks, time series models, to predict customer demand. Here we have an example from our factory in Erlangen, which is the Gerätewerk Erlangen, GWE, where we implemented a complete automated customer demand prediction tool that gives you a 52 weeks, so 1 year ahead in weekly buckets outlook of how the customer demand for the single project, single devices, products will develop. We have about 1,000 active products that you can order, which have different characteristics. So we have high rollers, medium rollers, also products that show stochastic demands, sporadic demand patterns. And we use the historical data of the customer demand along with business cycle data, purchase manager indices, macroeconomic data, seasonal effects in order to predict the demand. And from the demand, we develop a production plan that supports the material and capacity planning in the factory. If you like to see the workflow, so based on historical data, we have an automated model building process, an individual model for every active device that is manufactured at the plant in Erlangen. We analyze how good we are in forecasting that device, and we analyze the error distribution. It makes a difference if you over or if you underestimate the demand. And the better the forecast, the lower is the uncertainty behind the demand forecast. And this is taken into account when we formulate the demand plan based on the forecast and the uncertainty measure. And what is formulated here is a production plan for the next 3 to 6 months ahead. And what we can show is that especially for the top performing, so for the items with the highest revenue, we have a significant increase in the planning accuracy. And also, of course, because it's an automated model building instrument behind it, also in terms of process efficiency and costs. You can not only do this with pieces in the sense of demand planning, but you can also look at company figures, performance controlling. You can make forecasts of order intake, of revenue, of cash flow and profit, say for the next 3, 6, 9, or 12 months ahead, also taking into account the business climate or business cycle of your customers, macroeconomic data, internal planning data, also data from mergers, acquisitions, for instance, seasonal patterns to different quarters of the year are different. Also inside each quarter, the months show a different characteristics, and with such kind of instrument, you can improve the planning processes in financial management. You can avoid shortfalls of liquidity, for instance, and you can do a more proactive controlling. I like to point out that behind an AI project, I see at least four, let's say, success factors that have to come together. Of course, you need the data, because what we do is data analytics and data assessment and building models from data. You have to have the competence from the method side, so how to set up a neural network. You have to be aware of, let's say, the ecosystem state-of-the-art modeling tools like Python, Keras, TensorFlow, that so that you can also implement the model that you have in mind. And you have to combine, and you have to also to evaluate the data from the engineering perspective, from the perspective, what are the business requirements. You have to augment the data by the domain knowledge. For a mathematical model, every data point is the same, but with your knowledge in mind from the engineering, you might say, okay, we should not take, let's say, older data, or we should not take data from the ramp up or ramp down of the production process, and so on and so forth. And this is valuable information. Also, if you have physical models that help to augment the data and help to do a better pre-processing, and so you have a model that is also inspired by physical processes, I think the last part of this magic square is the user. He has to understand where are the limits and also the chances for an AI-based approach, so that he can put the recommendations that the model gives him into meaningful actions. And only if you work out a model which considers all those four edges of the magic square in the right manner, I think you can be successful. And this always involves doing an agile working mode, so a scrum process, for instance, also in an interdisciplinary team. And if you have a good model, you are able to increase the flexibility of your production, to ensure the quality, to be more efficient, or reduce time to market times. Well, I think a good project setup also consists of four steps. I mean, first is the ideation. So what is the use case? How can we describe the use case? What data should we use? What are driving factors? Then data engineering, collecting all the data, bringing it together, analyzing the data at first glance. Also evaluate the potential of the use case given the data or the data from a smaller data sample, and then if this seems to be promising, doing the prototype development in an interdisciplinary team of experts, and coming up in an iterative manner with a AI prototype model, testing this model, benchmarking this model, and if this is successful, then doing the rollout of the AI solution, also balancing edge and cloud computing concepts, having additional services, maintenance of the model, and implementing the model and putting it into action. Yeah, when when you look at the different trends and when you see what's going on currently in the field of artificial intelligence, I think one bottleneck is to have human resources that can do the model building. So experts in data science in one direction then is towards automated model building, mass modeling processes, data citizenship that helps also non-experts from the business field to work out machine learning models that are robust and that do a good job. One thing which is always in the need is you have to have a lot of data, especially for deep learning models, and here to be more data efficient because data acquisition is costly. Storing data is also arise from this arrives costs and further administrational efforts. So you want to be data efficient, and also if you have one model, you want to transfer it to similar problem settings in the sense of transfer learning. And I think this is also key to do this in a very cost and data efficient manner. And finally, I think what is also important is to have a holistic approach on AI, which not only considers image data, but also takes into account other data sources, and to bring all the different kinds of data and facets of a problem setting together in one holistic model, and not treating every, let's say, sub-problem as an individual one. I hope you find this webinar and this short insight on the application of artificial intelligence in food and beverage interesting. You see here are my contact details. Thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions, please do not hesitate to contact me, for instance, using here my email. Thank you very much.